Maritime Museum is down the way.
Refurbished dry dock at least of vessels is an example of the board encouraging private sectors involved in port operations.
Recorded history dating back to 1136 AD.
town doesn't only process its own oil and gas from here. There are several remote wells connected to the platform by subsea pipes, coming from the Hudson, Kestrel, and Falcon Field. It means these smaller reservoirs can be developed without the cost of having to build expensive platforms for each one, and the operating costs in turn can be shared. Being the focal point for these marginal fields makes keeping the town going very difficult. Oil from town and these other fields goes through a series of meters to be measured, and is then exported through an undersea pipeline to Tarka's North Comrade platform, and then onto its Comrade Alpha platform, where it joins the Brent pipeline to carry it all the way to the Southern Vogue oil and gas refinery and the ship in Dallas. But what happens to the reservoirs after the oil and gas is removed? My colleague Linda, who works on the platform's laboratory, can tell you more.
Over the years, as the oil and gas has been recovered, the pressure in the reservoirs has dropped. To make sure the oil keeps flowing up from the reservoir through the oil production wells, four large water injection pumps push water down into the reservoir through specially drilled water injection wells. The water moves through the reservoir, flushing out the oil and maintaining pressure in the reservoir. Because the water mixes with the oil in the reservoir, the oil flows more slowly, so we inject gas into the production well to increase the flow. The gas has to be compressed before injection into the wells, and it's easier to compress when cool, so the gas is cooled and compressed a number of times before injection. Small amounts of excess gas are burnt in a controlled manner at the end of the flare stack. My colleague Mike can tell you more about the platform itself.
I'm a technician, and most of my working time is spent on deck. Our platform is made of different self-contained modules, arranged on different levels and decks in order to separate hazardous areas, like the process modules, from the non-hazardous areas, such as the accommodation, where everyone eats and sleeps. Because the platform is so isolated, all of its supplies must make a long trip out by supply vessel or helicopter. Stores and equipment are moved between the vessel and the platform by two huge cranes that are also used to move things around the platform's decks. With so many people on board to feed, the kitchen, or galley, is continually preparing and serving food at meal times and work breaks. Most of the water on the platform that's used for drinking and washing is seawater that has gone through special filters and cleaning systems that remove the salt and any other impurities. Looking after the environment is a big concern of ours, and we make a lot of effort to separate out everything that can be recycled from anything that could before it all gets taken back to shore.
The central control room is at the very heart of platform operations. The control room operators can remotely interrogate and adjust most of the platform's processes from their consoles and get information about the remote fields connected to the turn. The continual demands made on all the process equipment and the age of the platform means constant maintenance, repair, and upgrade activities are needed to keep everything in good order. It requires a lot of investment to keep the platform working and safe, but the rewards can be high. It helps keep the UK supplied with the materials it needs for energy and manufacturing.
Because of the hazardous nature of oil and gas operations, safety is one of the key priorities on this platform, and my role as safety advisor is to make sure that no one gets hurt. We meet regularly to discuss how things should be done, how things can be improved, and to look at any problems we might have had so we can prevent them happening again. We have a big meeting every morning to talk about everything that may affect our work during the coming day and hold conference calls with our onshore colleagues if necessary. We also have meetings just about safety, and it's such a big part of our procedures that everyone has a say at these meetings through their safety representatives. All workers must wear protective equipment before leaving the enclosed safety of the accommodation module to help protect them against the hazardous environment. As well as the many safety systems on board designed to protect the platform and the people, the workers themselves are highly trained to cope with many types of situations. Regular safety drills and exercises are carried out to maintain a high level of expertise in handling unexpected events. Because of the danger of igniting any stray gas, work that will create flames or sparks is done inside an enclosed workshop area where cutting and welding can take place safely. All work needs to be carefully controlled and a permit to work is required before starting. The permit office issues and controls all the work permits.
As I'm most about, I work outside most of the time, helping out on the deck with the movement of equipment and other general duties. The turn's location means we have to cope with bad weather and rough seas almost all year round. The platform never stops working and operates around the clock, with everyone doing a 12-hour day or night shift during the 2 weeks they're on board. If there are any accidents, the platform's sick bay is fully equipped to deal with the most common medical conditions and injuries until outside support arrives. The medic performs health checks and can offer advice on keeping healthy. The laundry operates around the clock, making sure that the platform has enough clean linen, towels, clothes, and workwear for everyone. When people are not working, the recreation area offers various pastimes and games, and there is a gym to help keep fit. A friendly atmosphere and good humour is essential when you have such a large group of people all living and working together. There is an internet area to digitally connect with the outside world, and every cabin has its own TV and radio. And if you fancy a treat outside of regular meal times, you can buy snacks and drinks, as well as toiletries from the well-stocked barn, which is like a small corner shop. But even with all these comforts, it's a demanding job, and we can't wait to get on shore again and back to our families and friends.
We hope you have enjoyed your tour of the Turn Alpha, and we look forward to seeing you again. Have a safe trip back to the beach.
Look at the size of the lobster. So the miniature thing. Yeah, I'm looking for the insert.